guys, so we continue. We continue with the beams design. We cover the bending moment velocity, bending, which is Pmv. The maximum we can develop is Pmv. If Lb, the Andreas length, is more than Lb, it will be lower than that. We have equations to calculate. Good. Then we said we can design by charts, tables. This is what we will be doing in this lecture, how we use the charts and tables to design. Or we can select by Z. Yeah, the manual give us phi mm for the section based on the given length, or phi mv. Or you can go by Z. Yeah, we can calculate how much Z required and pick the first section with higher Z. So the and then we check, we started last lecture, the serviceability, deflection. How we check serviceability. We have four limits. We go for the live load deflection, for the live load and dead load deflection, whether it's a roof or a floor, or sometimes by a different area, and as an area. Maybe in your area they don't like to allow for more than 1 inch or 2 inch, and maybe this area will have their own thing. And according to the limit, it will like the deflection should not exceed this thing. Okay? So whatever limit you have, this is the limit. You can calculate from the analysis what's the deflection. And remember, deflection is calculated at the service loads. We use the service loads to calculate the deflection, and I is about the string axis, Ix, okay, Ix, no Z for deflection, Z is for string, that the elastic section modulus. Now the last force is shear force. What's the shear strength of the beam? What is the shear strength of the beam? And you compare this one with V ultimate from the analysis. Usually the shear is way more than V ultimate. Yeah, the shear strength of the beam is always, most of the time, is checked. Way higher than what you need. But how we calculate the shear force, it's good to know what's the code is allowing. What's the code is allowing? And what's the behavior of shear? And what's the behavior of shear? This is from structure analysis or any design course. And remember, the shear stress equal what? The shear stress due to a shear force equal VQ over IT. Right? Now, look, this is a beam. This is the neutral axis. What do we know about the neutral axis? Yeah, no one is telling you neutral axis. What? Wait. Says stress equals zero. That's wrong.
Bending
stress equals zero. That's the neutral axis. Bending stress equals zero. Shear stress? Maximum. That's also wrong. Because the shear strength, you cannot say equals zero or not zero. Or maximum or not maximum. The shear strength varies across the length due to the variation of the shear force. يعني تتغير حسب مع اللينك حسب تغير الشيء. Look, what is the equation? VQ tau equal VQ over IT. So for the beam, I is constant. T, let's assume, it's constant. It depends on where you studying this one. This change across the depth, Q equals zero here, Q equals maximum here. Okay? The first moment of area about the centroidal axis. And V is maximum at the support, decreasing as you go. Shear stress is changing across the length of the beam and across the depth of the cross section. Changes this way and changes this way. It changes across the length. Why? Because of the change in V. It changes across the depth because of the change in Q. Across the depth, change in Q. And sometimes there is also a change in the due to T. Look at the white flange. Okay, if you draw the shear stress, we said zero here. At any location, always zero here. Yani either if you are here, or here, or here, at the top is zero, because Q is zero. If there is zero shear here, it's also zero all the way. Now, so VQ at one location, V is constant, and look what's happening to Q, Q is increasing, so the shear stress is increasing. Right? I'm drawing the shear stress on this cross section. Got some guys, shear stress here. Should we see what happens here? the static amount of this about this point. This time, this is from here. Okay? Good? Now, this is a rule of thumb. Rule of thumb. Steel in tension will give you Fy. Okay? Or untensile strength, Fy. If you test the shear, you make a plate of steel, a bar of steel, and you apply pure shear on it, pure shear, it will fail at a stress smaller. يعني قوة الشير أقل. If you test it in tension. This is a theory property. هيك الله خلق. Usually this is 2/3. 1/6. Usually the shear capacity, shear, which is tension. Shear is tensile stress. Shear stress is tensile stress. Whether the shear force is positive or negative. The shear stress due to a shear force, whether positive or negative, always tension. يعني torque, positive or negative. What's the torque stress? Always tension. Shear force, whether positive or negative, what's the shear stress? Always tensile. يعني ليش احنا بنقول هاي انه minus shear ولا positive shear? For the moment. Because positive shear gives you positive moment, negative shear gives you negative moment. But the shear stress, always tension. Good? The Fb equal 0.6 Fy. This is by the code, usually 2/3, plus 0.66 or 2/3. That's known. From experimental testing. Look, Vn, what's Vn? Nominal shear capacity of a section. Nominal. This is the nominal. This is if you go to the lab, how much you get. Not the design. We know the design strength is the nominal times a strength reduction factor. And you know from now, you need to tell from the end, the strength reduction factor, your V factor, بتغير حسب طبيعة القوة. Depending on the nature of the force. يعني bending gives you flexure. Flexure is ductile failure. There are signs, إشارات بتصير failure. So it's kind of safe. It's not sudden, ductile. So the V factor, strength reduction factor, is usually high. 0.9. Shear failure is dangerous, sudden. Okay? So you expect to have more safety factor. So the strength reduction factor to be smaller, usually 0.75. And reinforced concrete in the columns, P0.65, P0.75 for spiral reinforced column or tile columns. For steel, it's 0.75. Or look now, you're gonna see something different now. On the next page, the strength reduction factor in shear you will see is high. Indeed, I'll tell you why. But look at the strength. And the shear strength, but what's the shear strength of this material? Then what's the area times the shear capacity. يعني واحد سألك steel وانت مش فاهم ولا شيء بقول له steel والله بيعمل leading Fy. The steel will lead at Fy. So I'm expecting the area times Fy. هيك بتتوقع صح؟ But now you learn هلا تعلمت انه the strength in shear is 60% or 0.6 Fy. So now you know Fv اللي هي like Fy but for shear equal 0.6 Fy. Now what's the shear area? All of this one. But look what the code is saying. The code only takes for the wide flank section this whip area or core area in the middle. Area of the whip. Yeah, for the wide flank section, W shapes, which is most of the shapes used for beams. Active sections, not only beams, 99% for beams are the wide flank shapes. The wide flange shape. Okay? What's the shear strength? The area of the whip, all of it, times Fv, which is 0.6 Fy. So the nominal shear strength, nominal, Vn equal 0.6 Fy Aw, area of the whip, which is given. Good? That's the nominal. So now you have a bonus of these. Did we include this? Not include this in the calculation of the shear strength of a W shape. That's why you have there is a shear buckling. There is a shear buckling. I'll tell you why. I'll tell you what's this one. That's why the shear, the V factor for the shear is 0.9. And in some cases you will see later on is 1. Why? Because the safety factor was taken by eliminating or excluding this advantage. We just consider the weight. We just consider the weight. And you know, those not only provide the shear area, they also provide confinement to the web. Confinement to the web. Now, look, there's shear buckling. What's shear buckling? It looks like there is a limit. There is a limit. Height. This is edge over T web. It's the limit. It's kind of, this is local buckling. Remember the local buckling thing? How we consider the local buckling? Right? Or buckling? Or buckling of the flexure member? It depends on and over R. So, if this thing, edge over T web, edge over thickness, edge over thickness, remember we checked the local buckling for these members? If it's less than certain value, the section will develop its full capacity in shear. What's the maximum shear capacity that the section can develop according to the code? 1.6 FYAW. You have standard. This is what we expect. This is, guys, this is fit well with the experimental data. بحثوا عينات H على W here, 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 here. Thousands of specimens. They will have a lot of points. They'll do the best fit. The best fit. Here, I think, and then they develop this equation. Look at this equation. There's a lot of factors. This is based on huge research. Look at this K. You will see K in the next page. Very complicated. This one, we assume it linear. This one, linear portion. This limit is this limit. This one is this limit. KV. You will see what's KV. Defined. Okay? Now, where is buckling? What, how the shear will cause buckling? How the shear? Understand. Look. Remember the column? The column. We have axial load on the column. Buckling will occur. What did we call that buckling? Flexural buckling. Flexural buckling. Or Euler buckling. Or global buckling. In quote, we calculate based on KL over R. We know how to calculate the strength. Right? Local buckling, we said there is something else. This is something else. But then in beams, we said there is flexural torsional buckling. Why? Because the compression flange is supported by the web, which is supported by the tension flange. So it doesn't buckle globally. It buckles with some kind of flexural torsional buckling. So look, now the action of the shear force, which is coming from the load, the tear shear force on the web, if you take one, like a unit width of the web, unit width of the web, this is the web, and there is axial force like this, right? It's kind of an axial on the column. كأنه الويب column. It's like the web is a column. And the force on the web is the shear force there. كأنها قطعة في plate. Okay? With the shear force there. So it may buckle this way, the web. Okay? If you have edge, if this is tall, compared with this. So sometimes the section is used normally, no problem with the shear. If you have a problem with the shear buckling, you will see on the beam, you will see stiffeners, vertical stiffeners. كل 2 feet or 3 feet, تلاقيهم حاطين لك بلاتي من كل جهة. Why? To brace the web against buckling or against shear buckling. Against shear buckling. عشان ما يصير shear buckling. Most of the time, you don't need it. في sections called plate girders. Plate girders. يعني sections, they are not available. مش standard section. Huge. الإطارات, when you have bridges for trains, you need maybe a 2-meter girder. 2-meter girder or 5-feet girder. يعني girder أطول مني. بشوفوها شوف الإطارات أو الأفلام. Huge one. They build it. It's called plate girder. يعني it's fabricated. بصنعوا flange, top flange, bottom flange, بصوهم. Web, then they weld them together. Okay? Those usually they require lateral stiffeners. Stiffeners to prevent buckling of the web so that the web will develop the full shear capacity. No problem with the shear. Okay, guys? So this is a table to if there is shear buckling and to check it. But usually we are here. We are here. Why the shear, the strength reduction factor in the shear is high? Because we excluded the effect of these. consider the strength of the web. What's the nominal shear strength of a steel member? 0.6 Fy in web. 0.6 Fy is Fv. That's the tensile shear strength of a steel. Tensile shear strength of a steel. If you go back here, this is just to remind you for structure and from structure analysis. There's something good. Horizontal shear stress equal vertical shear stress at the same location. This is horizontal shear stress. There is vertical shear stress. For equilibrium, this equals this. Right? Well, at the end, small end. To create the same cover, this has to be down and this is up. So they must be equal. This equals this, this equals that. And if you take some of the moment here equal to zero, this equals this. This times one equals this times one. So always there's something said. Horizontal shear stress equals vertical shear stress. This is what they mean. Equal to the diagonal tension. When we design for reinforced concrete, we don't design for horizontal or vertical, we design for that diagonal tension. Diagonal tension, if you calculate the value, is the same as V. But its effect is different. The magas. It's like a scissor. More effect. When you take reinforced concrete, they derive it for you. What's the diagonal tension? But the value of the diagonal tension is V. So if you look at this thing here, okay, if you want to check, we know how to do this. Okay, let's see, that's Fy, that's Kv. 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 Is there anything else other than Kv? The only thing we don't know is Kv, right? Calculate the shear strength, calculate the shear strength. If you have H over W, you have H over W, you can calculate anything. If your H over W is less than this value here, it's the following. If it's more than, if you are in here, you use this equation. If you are in here, this way. You can determine those, right? The only item you need to define this one is Kv. What's Kv? Kv usually is approximate value, and you are allowed to use. It's not here. Should be coming soon. You will see it here. Okay? So this is from the code, just to be sure. This is from the manual I have. Maybe the 13 edition. This is from the manual. Just the methods of calculating shear strength are presented below. The design shear strength, PV, VN, and the allowable, should forget the allowable. This is for the ASD allowance design. We are using that. LRFD, load and resistance factor design. The feed factor is 0.9. The feed factor is 0.9. And VN, we studied VN, which is 1.6 Fy. A will or something else depending on H over W. Depending on H over T. H over T, sorry. Do you have the manual for the beams? And for each section, it's calculated. Open for beams, open the beams design. The shear strength is always calculated. Vn is calculated for you based on this equation. And you check everything and it's giving you the value. Vn. Right. Let's comment it. This is the beam. Next lecture, I will show you how we design using these charts. How we design using these charts. This is the most important thing for beams. How we use these charts to design the beams based on Hamm alternator. This is W10 section. Any section, W10, what's V and N based equation to calculate the shear strength. Use the equation 1/6 of y times the area of the width, you get the area of the width, or the depth of the section times the width, and you multiply by the theta. Okay, guys, but it's calculated for you based on these concepts. So this specification is the same. Members with unstiffened or stiffened whips. In the wide flange, the whip is, in the W shapes, it's stiffened. In the T, the whip is not stiffened. Okay, unstiffened. If the stiffening is from both sides, we call it stiffened, remember? If it's from one side, we call it unstiffened or non-stiffened. So the number, but this section is for both. The nominal shear strength of unstiffened or stiffened whips according to the limit state of shear yielding and shear buckling, if you have all of them, is 1/6 Fy A whip CV. And this CV factor is 1 all current STM shear and except those meet the criteria set in section 4 Fy equals CV. It means CV equal 1 for all the sections except those guys. I mean 8 sections. And all the sections they have CV equal 1, except those guys after maybe now they already need these sections. They keep adjusting the manufacturing of these sections. It's not meeting the section. That's why those were excluded. But everything else, talking about 1,000 sections, many sections, they meet this requirement. It means CV equal 1. It means 1/6 Fy A1. But this is how the code report is. Remember the equation before? The only thing we need to calculate is K here. Or CV, or CV for the previous one. Or CV for the previous one. For whips of all other doubly symmetric shapes, semi symmetric shapes, and channels except round edges. So other sections other than the W, the S, the HV. You know what's S? S is unsectioned. S is unsectioned. But it's not wide in flange. The flange is not wide. We use it for beams. What's HV? W, the wide, the width of the flange equal the depth. D equal the flange. Very strong for columns. Rarely used for beams. Those, they have CV equal 1. Okay? By the way, those are doubly symmetric sections. Doubly symmetric. Symmetry about both axes, right? And except those, CV equal 1. Now he's telling you in the second one, for other sections, the HSS, he's not include the HSS. Any other doubly symmetric section, CV value in the equation is like this. It depends on the check. Depends on the check here. CV equal 1, if you are in between this one, CV equal calculated from here. And for H over this, CV is calculated from here. Where A, the overall depth, times the whip thickness, DTW in inches squared. We still did not get K. Did he give us K? No. Not yet. You see, guys, and CV in the equation before, equal 1 for the wide flange, for the S, for the HV, except maybe 5 or 6 sections. It's calculated from this table here, all of either one or this one, for other doubly symmetric sections based on the limit you have, based on this class. Okay? Now, what's KV? Okay. The whip length buckling coefficient KV is determined as follows for unstiffened whip with this here KV except 5. KV equal 5 except 4. The stem of these shapes were KV equal 1.2. So it's giving you a value then. Either 5 or 1.2 for the stem of the T. It's giving you the value. For stiffened whips, like the wide flange, KV equal 5, 5 over A over H squared, or 5 when A over H greater than 3, or A over H greater than this. And what's A is a little bit annoying, which is depends on the if there's a stiffening or not stiffening. But you can say, I don't care about this one if you want. You take KV equal how much? 1.2. For the stem of the T. Now here was the stem. And what's the shear strength of the T? What's the shear strength? Only this. Only this. And he's taking Kb in order to calculate. Why? Yeah, Kb is not in the equation. Kb is for us to know what's Cv. Kb is, we are using it only to know what's Cv. Why we don't need to know Cv? Because Cv is multiplied by 0.6 Aw and Fv. Okay? But this is for T, K equal 1.2. For unsteven, any unsteven section, any unsteven section is 5. For steven sections, you calculate it from here. Then you apply and check anything else. Okay? You can check everything else. That's the shear strength. Direct. Either you get it from here or you use the equations to calculate. But most of the time, it's 0.6 Fw Av. Sorry, 0.6 Aw Fv. P factors how much? 0.9. The strength reduction factor is 0.9. Some beams. Yeah, and you have a floor section. You have a slab, right? Usually this, as I told you in the previous lecture, is a metal dick, small sheet of metal with concrete on top of it, like ribs. Okay? This is supported by, floor beams underneath. They are carrying the slab. Those floor beams are supported by girders. You have a floor beam, let's assume there's a girder here and a girder here, are both wide flange sections. Okay? So there's a floor beam with a girder. Usually the top surface for the floor beam is the same as the girder. And this is the girder. The top surface of the floor beam is coming this way. Good? So the top surface is this way. So how are you going to fit them? And how are you going to connect the girder to the floor beam to the girder? You need to go down. The end needs to go down. So what we do, we cut some from the beam. We call it, we cut. We cut this piece, so this one now can slide within the flange of the girder. And this one, so that this one touches the whip of the girder. This is the girder, and that its whip. And girder, here, and this is the whip. So you need to bring the girder, the floor beam, so that this end of the floor beam touches the weight of the girder. So you connect them. You can weld them or have a blade on the girder to receive them. Either you weld there or you bolt. Good? So in order to do that, if you leave it as this one, if they have the same top, it will hit the top flange. They will hit each other. So you do this cupping. Called cup and beams. If you have to do something like that. Good? If you do something like that and you connect the beam to the girder with bolts, there might be a potential for flexion. Might be. And by the way, when you have a cup beam like this one, what's the shear strength of the cup beam? From here to here, that's your AW. So it will be H of the web minus the cup. And you should know how much the cup, maybe 2 inch or 3 inch, depending on the thickness of that flange of the girder. Again, so the girder will hold this one here, the girder will be here. So this beam and the web of the girder is here. Then you have, you weld 2 plates and girder. That's the girder. The beam will come here, right? So there will be a plate coming from here or a plate coming from here. The beam, the floor beam goes in between them. Then you bolt. Okay? Or if you want to weld it, you get it fixed. But usually the floor beams are pin connected to the girder. Pin connected. You don't need to fix them. And this could be enough. Okay? So if you have something like that, it's not something like that. You have to check that. This one. If this one to have it blocked here, this one will be chopped. Will be ruptured from the beam. If this one ruptured, we have area for shear and area in tensile. So either shear fracture plus tensile yielding or shear yielding plus tensile fracture. Remember this or this, depending on this one. So there is some one equation only for cup beams with bolt connected to the girders. There is an equation here. Direct. There is not like, there is no four. It's just direct equation. R and equal. 1/6 of ultimate. Of ultimate is given. A and V. We know how to calculate A and V. UBS usually 1. Factor, this is usually most of the time is 1 for standard section. FU we have A and T, net tensile. This are equal 1/6 FY is FY. A gross V, all of the times the thickness. Plus 1 FU A and T. And all this is known. And what's that? So the block shear strength? Phi times Rn. What's phi for the block shear? 175. 175. Good. Why 175 and there 0.9? 0.9 because we said it's we ignore some pieces. Here we do not ignore much. We are not ignoring much. And usually this one is rupture at the support joint. That's shear yielding. That's shear yielding. This is shear fracture most of the time. Fracture. Fracture is, although it's shear, a shear failure with a sudden, but shear yielding is slightly better than shear rupture or shear fracture. Okay, guys? Again, AGV, ANV, AGT, ANT, and you don't need AGT, right? You just need ANT, right? Then AGV and ANV, and everything is there. This information should be given to you. I will tell you what's the spacing between them, and what's distance, and what's the. And if I give you something to check, I will give you all these. Geometric information.
So to skip other beam, skip my book to get done.
Thank you, give me something. Okay, here. Okay, that's the girder between the girder usually a member between two columns. Yani the last beam that's connected to the column. Yani again, the general word is beam. You can have minor beam, floor beam, major beam, and the girder. They are all the same. The member, that the beam that is connected between two columns, it was between amudian, they call it girder. Usually, hamil beam then is carrying another beam. But that's the floor beam. Okay? And there is a slab here. But there is a floor beam coming this way. Let's assume the girder is going in that direction. And the girder, you have a floor beam on, or about 4 feet or 5 feet for floor beam, or 5 feet for floor beam, all the way. Yeah, you see the number the corridors. See the double T section? That's a floor beam. Okay, that's a floor beam. There is a girder on the side. If there is a girder on the side. Okay? So if you want to connect this one, remember the white flange has a flange. Has a flange. So if this is the same, the top surface is the same. That's the issue. It will not go. It will not go. And it will not go. Sometimes they do it. They bring the this one down or this one down, but usually they are on the same surface. How are you going to connect when you have the flange here? We cut part of the beam, the end of the beam. We cup it, C-O-P-E. Okay, it's called cup beam. Okay? The width of the flange, this way so that this one slides in there. It goes in there. Okay? Then you can have a plate here on the girder, plate here and here. So you bolt your girder to this one. That is usually welded to the beam. The plate, the receiving plate, and this is connection. This is connection design. Okay.
But for the ball beam, the girder, the width, the girder.
Sometimes, by the way, this is a rare situation. You know, you have a continuous beam, and the girder is at the bottom. That's usually you have the Emirati beams. Like this, the beams go and the girder is at the bottom. But this is rare. Why? Because you will require too much clearance and still sitting low. You only connect this way so that the girder is composite with the slab and the floor beam is composite with the slab. The slab is concrete, right? Slab is concrete. Okay. So this is how we check this one. There is an example, straightforward. there is an example, you can go over it. Straightforward, he's calculating everything, so he's answering any doubt you have. Any doubt. So for the shear strength, look, when we design based on flexure, right? We design based on bending. We don't design based on shear, we check shear. And the question will be, design or select the lightest shape, that will be shape or whatever, to carry the following load. For the following case. You calculate an ultimate, you go pick a section. Good? Then you check the shear. For shear, you have the section. For the shear, you have the section. It's just analysis. Good? Just analysis. And if you are given something like this, you should be able to check it. You have everything. You have everything. This is given. And this is given. Good? Straightforward. Okay, guys? So, next lecture, we'll have examples. Examples on the beam design and analysis. Okay, we need maybe one or two lectures. Then we'll start with the
Torsion combat.